Hello, and welcome to That's Squirrel Speaks. Today is Tuesday, February 4th, and this episode 97. Maybe. Yes. How are you? I'm your hostess, Amy Beth, also known as the Fat Squirrel on Ravelry, and the Fat Squirrel, S-Q-R-R-L, on Instagram. If you're a new viewer, welcome. If you're a returning viewer, I kiss your face. This week's episode will contain spinning and knitting. There are no shenanigans. There are shenanigans of the mind. I'm going to save them for next week because, quite frankly, I have a lot to do this episode. And I'm kidding you. Because we also have prizes to give away. And maybe at the end, depending on my technical abilities, there should be some spinning information. At the end, I have prepared a, it's like 20-ish minutes, about the Louette and my, I have a Louette S10 and a Ladybug, and really, it might be 20 minutes of the most boring information you've ever received, and I apologize for that. However, I had good intentions. So I will try to preface those intentions before I actually get into that portion of the episode. But for now, that's what's happening. Okay, so let's talk about what I'm wearing. Because it's part of my knitting finished objects. Well, it's all my knitting finished objects. Let's wear them all for funsies. I am wearing my Rikki hat. It's R-I-K-K-E. And it is by Sarah Young, and it is in hand spun that I spun from Cloud Lover. It's Rambouillet in the Lord Grantham colorway. I never know how to put that in order. Like, I need to Starbucks people to tell. Like, I was very, it was important to get my Starbucks order in the right order. Like, I never know how to say, like, the hand spun yarn order. Do you know what I mean? Because you say hand spun by Cloud Lover. Well, it's not really by Cloud Lover because she didn't spin the yarn, and that kind of is what that sounds like. But then if I say hand-spun, eye-spun from Fiber by Cloud Lover, that's like way too many words. We need shorthand. Let's think about it. Okay. But anyway. Shorthand, right? Clearly. I like it. It's garter stitch, you. It's garter stitch and homespun. I totally dig it. Okay, so there's that. I don't know, what else did I need to tell you? It was knit on size 2s for the brim and size 4s for the body. I knit it exactly like I was supposed to. I did exactly what I was supposed to in the pattern. Except I didn't knit it in the round, but I already told you that. I mean, I knit it in the round, but I didn't. I went back and forth because I'm lazy pants and I don't like to purl. There it is. This one has a little bit more body than my other one. I have another Rikki hat that I knit with Leadingman Fiber Arts DK base. And I can't remember the colorway. Into the Woods. This one is different. It's the same pattern, same stitch count, pretty much the same gauge, but my hand spun had a little bit more than the commercial spun hand-dyed yarn. So it has a little bit, I think probably the yarn itself was fatter, so the gauge is slightly denser, even though it measures out at the same, you know, it's slightly denser. So it has a little, it's more structurey feeling, but I totally dig it. It's so cute. I know. Okay, so then also I'm wearing my Carrapino sweater, which is by Carol Feller, and it is knit with, how many times have I said this? Really? Bartlett Yarns, who's a dyer in Maine, and I bought it at Rhinebeck. It is a cone of their sport weight yarn, and I used, I have lots left. I don't have enough to make another one, but I have lots left because I made mine short sleeves. Okay, so I'm going to try to stand up and show you my sweater. I may have to do some editing, but I've already done so much editing on that stupid spinning portion that I may not do anymore. I don't know. So here we go. Woo! So you can see that it's short sleeves. Can you see? Whoa! It's amazingly hard to stand up and talk to you. So can you see there are butt darts right there to allow for my ample rump? And I don't know, I totally dig it. So normally you'd be like, why don't you just zoom out? I can't pan out anymore. I've already panned out as much as possible. I have a gap in my curtains. It is daylight outside, see? But, since I was having so much trouble with backlighting, like 3 or 4 episodes ago, I decided to line my curtains with blackout liners. It's made an amazing difference, right? No more blacklighting. I don't have to record at midnight to get a good picture quality. So anyway, this is that sweater, and I like it. I was a little bit unsure. I don't know if you could see when I stood up. I don't know if it's that side or not. I didn't weave in my last end for the hem, because quite frankly, I wasn't sure if I needed to make it either longer in the back, because it is a smidge longer in the front. I think just because of the patterning. I was not sure if I should kind of do some short rows and bring the back down a little bit, but I think I'm okay with it. I'm going to live with it for a few days and see what I think, but I think I'm going to go with how it is. Because I'm like, it could be like a half an inch longer, even overall, not even just doing the back, short rows in the back. I'm like, maybe I should make it a half an inch longer, but then I'm like, really? A half an inch? I'm going to take out 2 inches of ribbing to make it a half an inch longer. I need to live with it for a few days and decide. So I'm going to do that. And yes, the pattern is written for, I believe, like a 3/4 sleeve or maybe even a bracelet length sleeve. But I love short sleeve sweaters now. They're perfect. They're so much more wearable for me personally. Because I get I'm cold because it's cold outside. We're getting more snow. And my husband is not here to shovel it this time. I'm not pleased. Anyway, what was I talking about? Oh, so this weight, sport weight is very versatile, I think, sport weight yarn in terms of warmth. Like I can wear a sport weight sweater and not feel like, whereas worsted weight, I'm like, I have to be outside if it's long sleeve pretty much. And we keep our house relatively cool, but not like subarctic. So I need to be outside if I'm wearing a worsted weight long sleeve sweater, but I can totally wear a worsted weight short sleeve sweater. And then also like, I don't have to worry about, if I have to wash dishes or even like wash a cup, I can just pull these sleeves up and not have to try to also pull a sweater sleeve up. Or if I'm doing like painting with the kiddo or something, you know what I mean? I just feel like it's very versatile. And then also, I don't have to worry about pills on the underseat of my, I definitely don't have to worry about them on the underside of my arm because, hi, there's no sweater there. But also not as much on the sides of the body because there's not another sweater surface. The surface of a t-shirt is much smoother, of course. So there's not as much pilling that goes on there either. And I just like that very much. I'm digging it. And then you don't have to knit sleeves. What up? Best thing ever. You don't have to buy yarn for sleeves. I'm pro it. I'm very pro. So I may be just high from my Miranda, but I don't care. I'm going to continue to be high. Okay. So I guess I went out of order, but I needed to because I was wearing things. It was weird not to like talk about that. Spinning! I have a finished option. Last week I showed you my singles. I had some Falkland singles by Godiva Yarns. And so here they are plied up. This is a total of 8 ounces. And her colorways don't have names, so I'm not going to tell you, so back off. And I didn't even count how much yardage there is. I think I started to, and then I just, there was a lot. not like a mil, because it's not even fingering weight, it's like DK-ish, I would say. But it was just a lot, too many things to count. But, so, here it is. I don't know, I like it. I do find that her yarn, I get a little fading in the wash. So maybe if you are spinning with her fibers, and not terrible, and it may just be, again, that there are certain parts of the fiber that are more saturated than, like, they have more dye on them than they can actually hold, as that rinses off. But just FYI. So it's a little bit more muted when it... But also part of the reason it's more muted because one bobbin was very light and one bobbin was dark. So, but there was dye in the water, but it's red and the red is harder to set. But just, you know, FYI. I would still buy from her again. I'm not saying I wouldn't. So there's that. I don't know what it's going to be. But I like it. It's definitely not my normal colorway, but I've been trying to get some more things that are not my knee-jerk colors. It's rosier than I would normally pick, but still warm. So I like it. Okay, now. Knitting works in progress. I have more knitting than this, but I'm not going to show you because, well, maybe I only have small amounts. I only have like a small amount more knitting than I'm going to show you. But I'm going to show you this. I started Miranda as part of our Gratitude Cal. What? So right now in the Fat Squirrel Speaks group, did I say we're going to do prizes? I think I totally left out prizes. We're doing prizes. Don't worry. Simmer down. In the Fat Squirrel Speaks group on Ravelry, we are doing a Gratitude Cal. This will be our third. This is our third one. Oh my gosh, that's so crazy. This is our third Gratitude Cal, third annual. And it'll run February and March. The rules are that it has to be something for yourself. It has to be a wearable or a blanket. I gave in on that one. I don't know why. Nobody asked. I anticipated the asking. It has to be for you, though. And when you're knitting it, the intention is to just knit with gratitude. So just to be thankful about whatever you want to be thankful about. You can be thankful about strawberries in December. Or you can not be thankful about that. But then don't think about that when you're knitting. You know what I mean? So just be thankful for whatever you are thankful about. Somebody's gonna be like, your carbon footprint! I don't eat strawberries in December. It just came to head. Shh. You can knit however many projects you want, but only one entry for our prizes. It has to be started in February, and you have to finish it before the end in March, the end of March. But again, you could talk in the threads about whatever. I mean, not whatever, but you know, you don't have to. That's to win a prize. You can still talk even if you're not entering for a prize. Does that make sense? I hope so. Serious. And shut up and just show us the knits. So this is my Miranda, and that's a pattern by Jose Paquin or something like that. And this is my third one. I have one for myself and one for my kid. This is knit with Elsbeth Lavold Silky Wool XL. It's an 80% wool. 20% silk blend. It's listed as an Aran. It's like Aran worsted, heavy worsted. It's 50 gram balls, and each ball has like 100. I want to say they have exactly 100 yards, but I could be a total liar. 95 meters, 104 yards. And this is colorway 8008, the blue green colorway. And it is on sale at Webb's right now. I think they're discontinuing it for five. Okay, at the time of this recording. It's like five something a ball. That's a lot of information, right? There's also an orange one. You know how hard it was not to buy the orange one? I might still buy the orange one. Shush. So I kind of knit like a demon on this because I'm crazy. It's really fun to do a top-down sweater because it's just like, yes, let's get to that armpit. And now I will slow down significantly. For one thing, I would like to do a Ravelinix project, which starts tomorrow. I'll talk more about that next week, which I'm going to try to do a sport weight Viajante or something like it. I'm going to do a Shanjoyo, with some Beaver Slide Dry Goods sport. So this probably won't get as much attention next week, so I really wanted to get some done on it. And also, it was just really fun to make. And I need to be able to wear it to Paula's retreat, so I have to get it done before then. Anyway, so I'm about 2 inches past the armhole. I'm doing exactly what I did on the last one. I increased as suggested. I am knitting the size for this circumference, so my upper bust circumference, which is 46 inches. So that's the size I'm knitting, but then I'm adding 8 inches in for my rack, to be honest. I know that's a vulgar word, but whatever. 8 inches in for my breasts. That seems even more vulgar now that I said it in that context. Oh my gosh, I'm not editing anymore. So I'm adding 8 inches in, and then I'll take about 4-ish inches out in decreasing underneath the bust line. I'm sorry, those of you who have children watching. I'm not sorry. I've seen regular TV. I'm way more Protestantastic than regular TV. Which is ironic. What was I going to say? So I just increased as suggested until about halfway through the arm, through the depth of the arm scythe. Is that how we say it? People told me, and I appreciate it, and I need to look up how to pronounce it. So cute. And I'll talk more about that when I talk about finishing up the other sleeve, which, of my fixing up sweater. That's going to be a while. Just to be honest. But I'll talk more about that then. What am I talking about now? I'm not really sure. So I did the increases as suggested until halfway through that depth, and then I increased every row. So which essentially is like where the cup of my bra starts is like, you know, starts to get, that's where I started pretty much doing the extra increases for the bust. And then I knit 2 inches below the armhole, and then I start decreasing for the bust. Again, I say it every week. It's a lot of me talking, people. I don't know why you're still watching. And then I'll also put butt darts in this one because I am in love with butt darts. Just gonna be honest with you. What I'm laughing about is I'm really trying to imagine the transcript of this podcast. It's ridiculous what I'm saying, it right? Just imagine the transcript without any other context. I just said bust, rack, boobs, but like way more than is average in any short period of conversation. I would probably be tagged as like adult. Just saying. Knitting podcast. Anyway. So that's all the knitting I'm going to show you. Oh my gosh, it's been a long day, people. I'm so sorry. Let's talk about prizes. Can I redeem myself by giving you stuff? Let's try. Okay, so I closed the prize thread right before I started recording. Something. I think like very before I started recording this bidding part. So we had 586 entries. I did go through to make sure that there were not doubles. I tried to remember to email everybody that I deleted a post. If I forgot, I am sorry. I just deleted one of your posts because you could only have one because it's a prize thread. But I tried to put your question in the other one. And will I answer these questions? I will try to answer them like as we go. I haven't quite figured out like how to methodically answer them all. Because my tendency is just to be like, oh yeah, somebody asked that. But I do want to somehow do it methodically so I can make sure I get to all of them. Because some of them were really good questions. Well, they were all great questions. But some of them were just like one person asked it, so I might forget. So I'm going to figure out a way. I need to like export that into like a CSV file. Can I do that? I don't think I can do that with Ravelry. I don't know. Anyway, I need an intern. So need an intern. So we had the random number generator. I still have it up. I already generated because I can barely function as it is. I cannot go through between multiple devices. So it was between between 2 and 586. And so I got these numbers. So there you can tell, you can freeze frame and check me. Okay. So the first prize is going to be the Bling Your String. If you win a prize, please PM me on Ravelry with your real human name and your address, mailing address. Please put prize or something like it in the subject line so I can find you easily. If you can remember to put what you won in your message, that'd be great too. It just makes it a little easier for me. But if you don't, it's okay. Prize number one. From Bling Your String. This is one of her, she does a Project Pouch of the Month Club. So this is one of the shipments from the Bold and Beautiful Club. You get a Project Pouch. You get some matching stitch markers. On this one, she even sent you a matching Notions pouch. Do you see, can you see it in there? Probably not. But it's totally in there. You get all sorts of goodies. She's so cute. And she's so generous. So this one is going to number 67. Do you know what number you are? Pattern Whisperer. Yay, Jerry won! And if you've won a prize, please still send me your address. I can't look for things. I can't be trusted. She's very lucky. You should try to put your entry around her. If you see her, put a post up. Just put your entry around her. She's very lucky. Okay, Next prize. Also from Banger String, we have, which one was this? I think it was Lions, Bears. No, this is not Lions, Bears, and Pigs and Lions. That was the last one we did. This is like an Under the Sea or Oceany Tastic or, I can't remember the name, I'm sorry. But also from Banger String. It has cutesy little mermaids of happiness on it. Aren't they silly and cute? And of course, your matching stitch markers. Did you so fancy? This one goes to number 212, who is Knitty Purl One, Lynn. Okay, the next prize is from our beautiful plover bird. She sent you this prize. Isn't it cute? I have my socks in it right now. So it's a little socky size one. And it has a little handle. And it's super lovely and wonderful and great. And that prize goes to number 471. Three dog knit chain. Jane asked what kind of spinning wheels I have and how long I've been spinning. That will be addressed at the end of the episode, Jane. Except I don't think I said how long I've been spinning. I learned to spin. So I've been spinning since January 2 years ago. So I'm into my third year of spinning, just barely. Okay, there you go. And then the rest I'll talk about at the end. Okay. prize number 4. Self-striping yarn. From the beautiful Juliana's Fiber with an R-E. It's julianasfibre.com. It's fine. She's fancy. And it's 80% superwash merino, 20% nylon, 420 yards. And this is her colorway, Ravenswood. Isn't it pretty? Her self-striping is gorgeous. And that goes to number 212, which is Gathers No Moss. Becky! And then, for the last prize, I donated 2 skeins of my hazelnut. So it's an 80-10-10 superwash merino. Cashmere nylon. This is 400 yards per skein. This is the spring leaf colorway. So yeah, you get this. And that one goes to number 403. Nuts for Needles Heidi. All right, I think that's all of it. Hooray! Okay, so now, in theory, this is only in theory, people. In theory, I'm going to insert a video of me talking about spinning stuff. Okay, but this is what I would like to do before I do so. I need to preface me talking about the spinning stuff. Oh, I've left a... Okay. Oh my gosh. So this is what I did for the spinning part of the video. On the knit girls, they had a question about like comparison wheels. I have a Louette S10, which is a bobbin driven wheel, and I have a Ladybug, which is I use on Scotch tension. You can use double drive, but I always use Scotch tension. My Louette S10 was my very first wheel. I got it in January, 2 years ago. I got it used off Craigslist. From a couple of gentlemen who had just recently upgraded to Ashford production wheels, which were very pretty. But I knew nothing about how to spin when I got it. Like, I mean, theory. But I had never spun on a wheel when I got it. So, yes, that was my first wheel. And I learned to spin on the Louette S10. The video, what I tried to do in the video, which again, maybe 20 minutes of me floundering. You don't want to watch it. You don't need to watch it. There's no secret prize or fonts of knowledge involved. But what I wanted to talk about is a lot of people have trouble. Well, I shouldn't say a lot of people because that's totally an exaggeration. At least one person has told me they have trouble spinning singles on their Louette S10. And that is because the Louette has a lot of uptake. It pulls on your single with such a force that for me, I cannot spin anything finer than the single that will make a 2-ply sport because it just breaks. I break my singles. Like if I try to spin anything less than that, even just spin a single that will eventually ply into a sport, is difficult for me on the S10. Some people can do it with no problem. Some people can spin, and they make lace weight flyers. I talk about this in the video a little bit. They make a lace weight flyer, lace weight bobbin, which decreases the amount of uptake that you're getting. And so you can spin finer wools or finer fibers in general. But it's a it was a problem for me, and that's eventually why I got my ladybug. Because with the Scotch tension, you can create much less uptake and therefore spin a much finer single without breaking it. So that was really what I tried to explain in the video, but I might have gotten a little bit crazy. Because instead of just telling you what I just told you, which took, what, a minute and a half? I really felt the need to like break out equipment and like give some sort of quantifiable difference between the uptake on the Louette S10 and the Ladybug. Sometimes you get a problem in your head and it won't leave and you just roll it around like a rock in a river until it's a tiny, tiny pebble and it is now in, it's totally like inconsequential to the world, but you just held on to it for too long and so you had to make it happen. So that's what's happening. My like honest self-editing self would normally not put this video out there, but quite frankly, I spent a lot of time trying to make it, and so now I'm just gonna do it. Put it out there. At the very end of the video, I do show a little bit of how I spin. It's not professionally done at all. I have black skirt on, so it's kind of hard to see the fiber, but it was just casual. It was not meant to be like a tutorial in any way. It's just us talking, just coffee talking. So yeah. That's all for this week's episode, and I will see you next time. Bye. Okay, so I have actually no idea if this is going to work or not. and Annie is probably going to mess with the tripod and make everything crazy, and I'll probably knock a camera over at least twice. But hey, we'll try. Okay. So a couple of people have asked what kind of wheels I have. This is my first wheel. This is a Louette S10. A little bit better there. And I apologize, I'm not gonna like be clever and move the camera around because it took me far too long to get any sort of angle that I thought might work for this demonstration. So this is my little S10. It is an old one. It's probably late 70s, early 80s. It's a single treadle and it's bobbin driven. So you use a little bit of Scotch tension and double drive. There's also a bobbin driven wheel. And a couple of people who have bobbin-driven wheels, or just people in general, I think, and I can't remember who, but on the Knit Girls, they had a question about Scotch tension versus other sorts of tensioning devices. This wheel is tensioned by adjusting this leather strop. It's really a strap, but strop is kind of fun to say, don't you think? So, theoretically, there's a little device over here. See right here. This thing right here. Ooh, left and right's crazy. And you would attach that like that and tighten it. That pushes down more on the flyer, which then creates more uptake with the thread on the bobbin, the yarn on the bobbin, or loosen it to create less. However, this wheel pulls very hard. So actually, I have never used, while making yarn, I think aside from when I first started when I thought I was supposed to, I have never actually tightened this while making singles. I do sometimes tighten it when I am plying, especially as the bobbin fills up. I will sometimes tighten it just to get more uptake, to get those singles plied faster or more quickly. But yeah, I never use this while I'm spinning. Usually I just let it sit there. I don't typically pull it back just because then it like gets in the way of the orifice, which is obnoxious. But I don't actually tighten it. It's not even in the little fixture where it should be. So this is a very clever idea, which we're going to find out if it works right now. One of the nice things about the Louette wheels, and by the way, and that is no way to indicate that Louettes are not a great wheel. I just had trouble getting finer singles on it. You can buy a lace flyer, which is a much lighter weight assembly here, lace bobbins and a lace flyer. So it's much lighter weight, So again, if you're pressing more on this, it creates more uptake. So if this whole thing is lighter, it creates much less uptake, and you can get much finer singles that way. I just didn't really want to invest in that. And some people don't have to invest in it. Some people are completely able to spin a very fine single, but they're magic, and I am not. So one of the nice things about the Luette, we'll just talk a little bit in general. One of the really nice things about the Luette is when you need to change bobbins, that's all you have to do, which is super awesome. Don't judge me, my wheel is dirty. It's been in the attic. Hush. That's all you have to do, put the bobbin back on. Another great benefit of the Luette, it has a giant bobbin. Woohoo! You can really put at least 8 ounces on here easily. What I often do is make like a little cardboard template for the, for this place, for the side of the bobbin. I'll just make a cutout that's a little bit bigger than the actual whorl size here. And you can put, like, I think I've had like 10 ounces on one bobbin. So they are a very nice big bobbin, which is excellente. And that's how you increase, that's how you change your ratio speed or your whorls, is just by flipping the bobbin from one side to the other. You can see this side has a small, and so it's faster, and that is large, and so it goes slower. And there are different bobbins as well that you can get either smaller or larger. And of course, just for funsies, my band came off. Which is, that's okay if you're not familiar. Okay, so one of the things I thought I might be able to do to demonstrate the difference in pull or pickup force on the Luette. That's my dog. She's excited about a bird. So you're going to hear her claws against the back door. We're actually in my laundry room. Isn't that exciting? We're in my laundry room because it has the most windows that are not covered by quilts this time of year. So it has the most light, hopefully. And I can open the door and get more light. So I bought this little doohickey. This is just a luggage scale, or what I prefer to call a fish scale. And not the scale that's on the fish, but in fact a way to weigh your very fancy giant fish that you've caught. And what it does is it ranges, you can do kilograms or pounds. We're just going to do kilograms because, well, this measurement actually has no, like, contextual meaning. I'm just going to use it as a comparative measurement between the Luette and the Ladybug, which is the other spinning wheel I have.
So we're going to try this again. I came back with, I was having some trouble with my leader slipping. So I've come back
and just put a little bit of just scrap yarn on there, just to hopefully give us more accurate information. So again, with the scale, oh my gosh, really? Okay, now I'm going to treadle with the brake band, or whatever you want to call it, completely off. We are getting, this is not highly scientific, people. 0.21 kilograms of essentially force, right? It's pulling against it. It's a measurement. It's not necessarily the correct unit that we would want, but again, we're just doing a comparison. So shush. I thought I was terribly clever. Okay, so then we're going to put this dude on, and I'm not actually tightening it. I'm just putting it in to the little mechanical thing that it belongs in. Okay, so we are back to basics here. Okay, and okay, so you can see with that, we have 0.42 kilograms of force exerted. Now, if I actually, and I'm just letting some of the twist come out of this so it doesn't get completely insane. So then if I actually tighten this, let's see, let's do it scientifically. I'm going to tighten it. One, I think that was about one full rotation.
You don't need one.
Okay, so we're going to try again. Oy vey, what's the goodness? Okay, so we are going to tear and treadle. I don't think it would make a difference. See, we're coming up to like 0.96. 0.97. Okay, so we almost have an entire kilogram of pressure being put on that single.
So that gives you a pretty good indication, right? We went from, what, 0.21 all the way up to 0.97, and this is not in any way tightened all the way. This probably needs to be lubed. It does need to be lubricated. I'm not going to mess with it because I'm not using this wheel very much right now, and I don't need to lubricate it and then have it collect dust, which is gunky. So that might cut down on that force a bit too, but not noticeably. I mean, I can feel it when I'm spinning, and that's about what it feels like. So I'm going to go get switch out wheels, and I'll be back in a moment. Okay, so now we have the ladybug out. So I'm going to go ahead and switch off this bobbin because it has good singles in it. I don't want to mess them up. Okay, so sorry about that telephone number if I didn't edit that out. So somebody asked about outtakes, if there were outtakes. There are never outtakes of this show because I don't edit. I do edit a tiny bit. Like if there's just a moment where I stop talking, like because I've just, my mind wandered somewhere, then I will. So if you don't have a ladybug or aren't familiar with one, this is the flyer, of course. This is the bobbin, which I just slipped. This is a plastic travel bobbin. The singles I just showed you were on a wooden bobbin. They're slightly more expensive, and they're wooden instead of plastic on the ends. I like them. They tend to do this a little bit less while I'm spinning. And this is what gives you your ratios, your differential ratios. So there's this one, and then there's that bigger one for fatter yarn. And you just put that on there and tighten up your flyer. Now, so on this wheel, the tension is applied to the bobbin through this little bit of hempy kind of string, which is down here, and it's on a spring, which you can't see. Maybe you can see. Oh, there you can see. Which is on this, and then there's a little knob over on this side. See right there? And you turn that, and that applies more force to the strip, pulls it down, creates more uptick. So usually I spin with very little tension. You can see, you can't see. I can see and tell you that this string is barely just lifted up. Like when you turn the tension all the way off, the spring will just, like there's slack, okay? I apply tension until that spring just lifts up a bit, and essentially until there is just hardly any pull on it, but so that it's not laying down. And you just watch. Most people, I guess you're supposed to tension by actually feeling it, but, well, that's just how I do it. And then I adjust if necessary.
Okay, we're going to try one more time.
See if we can get a consistent... It's really hanging between 0.65 and 0.9. I think it's just such a small amount of force, that it's not. This is also just now the force of the yarn kinking. So it's not going to give me consistency. So I apologize. I would have preferred it to be consistent. Oh no, it's giving me consistency because I'm actually pulling on it. I think it's just such a little amount that it's not really, it's fluctuating like a greater percentage of its whole, so it's not going to lock in. So now we're going to go ahead. So basically, again, at the highest, we'll call it 0.09. At the highest. So really, I mean, we were down 0.05 was 0.05 to 0.09 kilograms of force. So again, even with that, that is compared to the 0.2 that we had. So we're talking about 3 to 4 times the amount of force that we were working against on the Luette. And I'm going to go ahead and just increase the uptake. Well, let's see. You barely have to touch this. I mean, you barely have to increase uptake. I'm just going to do it for the purposes of demonstration and increase it quite a bit and see what we can go up to. Okay, so let's tear that. Let's get that going. Let's lose our leader. That sounds fabulous. Okay. Okay. All right, let's try this again, shall we? Okay. Okay, see, that's what it was. Just not enough force. So even with the tension pulled up way higher than I ever do when I'm doing singles. So anyway, that was just a way to demonstrate, I hope. And it may not be anything anybody cares at all about. But I was curious about it because I knew that there was a difference. And I was trying to figure out how we could discuss, like, in some sort of quantifiable way, the difference between the uptake on the two. Ooh, I need to tighten my doodly-doo here. Woohoo, it's crazy. Yeah, just noticed that is loosey, loosey, goosey. Anyway, so some kind of quantifiable versus me just saying, yes, the uptake on the Luette is much greater than the uptake on the Ladybug. So, hopefully, I don't know, this may get edited out into just like me showing you the numbers. Oh, that might happen. But we'll see. You never know. So that is the difference between the two. I mean, there's more than one difference, but that's... The shot also, of course, you can do double drive with the Ladybug. I really looked a lot into double drive versus Scotch tension. And I think it really just boils down to what feels better to you. Because there seems to be no consensus on necessarily what one can do versus the other. I think it really just is what you're comfortable with. And I like Scotch tension. I like how easy it is to adjust and how you can get very little amounts of tension and still get some sort of some sort of uptake that's useful for getting your yarn onto the bobbin. Is Annie making a cameo? Oh, no, you can't see her. Can you see her? No, you can't see her. Hi, Annie. You're not going to... Okay, you can go the other way. All right, that's fine. So then some people asked how I spin. So we'll see. I don't know how this is going to work at all. I'm going to mess a bunch of stuff up. Are you ready? Because that's what happens whenever you try to show somebody else how to do something, is that you have to mess up. Okay, actually what I'm going to do is stop the camera and move. Okay, so some people have asked how I spin, or perhaps how I spun on the Luette, because I learned to spin on the Luette, and I taught myself to spin with help from videos, YouTube videos, and from a couple of videos I rented from or checked out from the library, and a few that I actually purchased as well. So I have a lot of different resources. They just weren't actual human resources. So it's not like I just pieced it together out of the sky. But what I do is I don't have... Like, the way I spin is neither worsted nor woolen, technically. Can you see that? I don't know if you can see or not. In a traditional worsted spinning, you never let the twist go into your fiber supply. I think because I learned to spin on the Luette and there was such a great uptake, fighting to keep that twist out of my fiber supply was very difficult and very hard on my hands. Just, it was very tiring for my hands. So I think because of that, I just don't spin that way. So what I really do is I kind of do a supported long draw, but I don't do a very long draw. I kind of do some sort of, it's between, see, it's going to mess up because I'm nervous. Because you're watching me. So I pull back with my right hand, my fiber supply hand, and my left hand is, sometimes if you'll notice, I roll my thumb back. And that's to get a little bit, this is really what I'm doing. See how there's some twist in there? When I roll my thumb back, it just untwists that. So less spin in the fiber supply. But I never pinch to keep it out of there, because to me it just feels more natural for the wool to essentially draft itself. I mean, I'm drafting it too, like I'm pulling back, but the wool it's grabbing onto itself, and it just depends on how fast I treadle and how fast I move my back hand. It's going to tell how much wool is going to go into the single. So, yeah, I do somewhere in between, which I think is what we all do. I mean, there are certain people who do straight up inchworm or only do long draw, or, but I think a lot of us kind of get into something in the middle that works for us. And you better darn believe it that women 200, 300, 400, 500 years ago were doing the same thing. You know, there wasn't, there might have been, I need to wheel my wheel, listen. Sorry. I kind of like that sound. Like, I like my wheel to make a little bit of noise. It gets fun when it really just does go swoosh, swoosh, swoosh. But I also don't mind if it makes a little bit of noise. It just adds to the rhythmic effect for me. So I don't know. I feel like that's had to be how we did it a long time ago, right? I don't know. It might have been like our mothers slapping our hands so that we did it the way she did it. But I don't think she was like, J.C. Boggs only says you can do this thing. Of course, J.C. Boggs never told you that. I'm just, hers was the first name that popped to mind. So yeah, that's how I spin. I don't know. It's magic, right? If you don't spin, if you do spin, you're like, oh my gosh, she's doing it so wrong. Her singles are totally uneven. Guess what? I'm not spinning for you people. I'm spinning for the people who think it's magic. That's right. So that's how I do it. I don't know, again, my class at SSK last year in the July was the first time I had taken any spinning course. So I just kind of do what works for me. And yeah, I want to learn new techniques. I want to learn new things. But I think I'll probably always kind of revert back to this because it's what feels good to my hands. It's relaxing, which is what I want this activity to be. And it gives me a yarn that I like. You know, it's not fancy. It's not always even. Not always evenly twisted. It's not always evenly plied. But it's functional yarn, and I like it. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it, I guess. So anyway, before you all cringe anymore at the sounds of my wheels, I will go ahead and stop this. And if I do, in fact, put this at the end of the episode, which I believe I will, we will call it a day, and I'll talk to you next time. Bye!